Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Hadith 336. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال صليت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات ليلة فقمت عن يساره فأخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم برأسي من ورائي فجعلني عن يمينه متفق عليه. From Abdullah ibn Abbas, he says, one night I got up to pray with the Prophet and stood to his left, so he took hold of my head and dragged me from behind himself towards the right. Muttafaqun alayh. We find in this hadith that Abdullah ibn Abbas, who was one of the young Sahaba, was extremely eager to learn from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And we know he grew up to be one of the scholars of the companions and one of the greatest mufassireen of the Quran. So in this narration, here he is spending the night at the house of the Prophet, who was married to his aunt Maymuna. So we take that it is permissible to spend the night in the house of one of your relatives, and a man is allowed to spend the night in the house of one of his female maharim if her husband will agree to this. If he will not agree, then he is not allowed, because the husband of the wife has most right in the house. We also take from the narration the virtue of Ibn Abbas, in that he was one of the Sahaba who was close to the Prophet ﷺ. And in some narrations we find that his father, Al-Abbas, who was the uncle of the Prophet, sent his son, Abdullah ibn Abbas, to spend the night with the Prophet so that he could see the Salah of the Prophet. We take from the hadith that it is permissible for a man to begin the prayer on his own, so this is his intention, and then he changes his intention in the middle of the prayer to become an imam, which is what happened with the Prophet in this case. Some people say that the Prophet was expecting Abdullah ibn Abbas to join him, so this is why it is allowed to change the intention. Otherwise it is not. But we say no, that's not correct. The Prophet was not expecting Abdullah ibn Abbas to join him, because Abdullah at that time was a small kid, and you probably don't expect a small kid to get up in the middle of the night and start praying. So we say it is permissible to change your intention from being on your own to being the imam, and also vice versa. From being the imam to being on your own is also permissible. So if you're praying with someone else in the Salat al-Jama'ah and that other person has to leave the prayer because maybe he's broken his wudu or for some other reason, then it is permissible for you within the prayer to change your intention to being a lone prayer. However, this idea of changing your intention is not always permissible. For example, if you are praying Salat al-Dhuhr and you change your intention to praying Salat al-Asr, or perhaps the other way around, you're praying Salat al-Asr and you realize that you forgot to pray Salat al-Dhuhr. So within the prayer, you change your intention to Salat al-Dhuhr. This will break your prayer off, because Salat al-Dhuhr is a fard prayer, and you need to make your intention before you start the prayer, not afterwards. Because your deeds are judged by your intention, and you will have what you intended. And because intention is one of the conditions for the prayer to be correct, this must happen before the prayer begins. Just like the wudu is the condition for your prayer to be correct, so this must happen before the prayer begins. You cannot make wudu during the prayer. Likewise, you cannot make your intention for Salat al-Dhuhr during the actual prayer. It must be before. Similarly, if you're praying a nafilah and you change your intention for it to be a fard prayer. For example, you're praying two rak'at of Salat al-Duha and you realize that you forgot to pray Salat al-Subh. So you change your intention that instead of praying Salat al-Duha, this prayer is now Salat al-Subh. We say no, your prayer is completely broken. Because now what's happened is that you have neither intended Salat al-Duha nor have you intended Salat al-Subh. So you're not actually praying anything anymore. What about if you're praying a Salat al-Fard and you change your intention to a particular Nafila prayer? For example, two rak'at of Tawaf. We say all your prayer is broken. The Fard prayer is broken, because obviously you don't intend the Fard prayer anymore. But also this rak'at-ay al-Tawaf is also broken, because this is a particular sunnah in which you need to have your intention beforehand, not in the middle of the prayer. The combination which is allowed is if you change your intention from a fard prayer to an absolute nafila, meaning to say a nafila which is not prayed for any one particular reason, just any nafila, that is allowed. And the reason why we say this is because when you pray and make your intention, actually you're making intention for two things. Number one, your intention to actually pray. And number two, your intention for a particular prayer. For example, a particular Salat al-Duha, or Salat al-Dhuhr, or two rak'at of Tawaf. A particular prayer. So these are two parts in your intention. However, when it comes to an absolute nafilah, then this second part is missing. It is not prayed for any particular reason. So it is not a particular nafilah. It is just an absolute nafilah, just praying, which is not done for any particular reason. And we say both of these ingredients, which were mentioned, must be present before you begin the takbiratul ihram. But the point is, if you change to an absolute nafilah, then you have not broken the intention, because the first ingredient of the intention, which is just the prayer itself, remains intact when you change to an absolute nafilah. But this does not hold true when you change to a particular nafilah. For example, Salatul Duha. So when you're praying Salatul Duha, you have to have the intention, first of all, that you're praying, and secondly, that this is a particular nafilah, which is Duha. And both of these parts of the intention must be present before you make the takbiratul ihram. So this basically means you're not allowed to change your intention from, let's say, Salatul Subh to Salatul Duha, because your intention to pray Salatul Duha was not present before you made the takbiratul ihram, because you made the takbiratul ihram for the Salatul Subh. However, you can change to an absolute sunnah, because in this case your intention remains intact. So notice the difference. What if somebody says, okay, changing this intention from a lone prayer to being an imam only can happen in the nafila prayer, because the Prophet here was praying in the night time. We say no, what is good for a nafila is good for a fard. And in fact, we have an evidence for the fard. Remember, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was leading the people in prayer, and the Prophet ﷺ came and sat to the left of Abu Bakr and began to lead. So here, we find that Abu Bakr had to change his intention from being the imam to being a ma'mum. So this change of intention does not harm the prayer, because he did not change his intention to praying a different fard prayer. If he had done that, then this would break the prayer. We find here that Abdullah ibn Abbas came and stood to the left of the Prophet, and the Prophet turned him towards his right hand side. So we say if two people are in the congregation, the ma'mum stands to the right of the imam. And this is a recommendation and not a fard. And the reason why we say this is not fard is because the Prophet ﷺ did not give a verbal order that when two people are standing in a congregation, then the ma'mum must stand on the right. So this ruling now is only established by the action of the Prophet, not a verbal command. And our law in Usul al-Fiqh tells us that those acts of worship which are established merely by the action of the Prophet cannot be wajib, at most they are mustahab. So based upon this, if the ma'mum stands to the left of the imam, and there are only two of them, then the prayer is correct, although it is not the preferred way. As for if anyone says that the salah is not sahih because it opposes the sunnah, we say you need evidence to say that the prayer is not correct. Because as long as the conditions of the prayer are met, the arkan are performed and the wajibat are performed, then who can say that the prayer is not correct? Yes, it's true, it opposes the sunnah. But just because you oppose the sunnah does not mean that your prayer is not correct and that you have to redo the prayer. That's a completely different issue. And also notice how the Prophet ﷺ did not tell Abdullah ibn Abbas that in future when you stand, you must stand to the right hand side. If it had been wajib, then the Prophet would have told Abdullah ibn Abbas to stand on the right, and this would have been a verbal order from the Prophet. But we say mere actions do not denote obligation, rather they denote recommendation at most. It's the same thing with the number of rak'at that the Prophet prayed in the nighttime prayer. 11 or 13 is a recommendation. It is not wajib. Likewise, when he would come home, the first thing he would begin with is the miswak and brush his teeth. But he never gave a verbal order. So we cannot say it is wajib for you to brush your teeth with the miswak the first instance you come home, because this is a sunnah established by a mere action and not by a verbal order. Some people also use this hadith to say that the one who stands behind the congregation on his own, his prayer is correct. So let's say you have a congregational prayer and you come into the masjid and you stand on your own behind the rest of the congregation. So they say this hadith proves that the prayer of this person is correct, because Abdullah ibn Abbas went from the left to the right behind the Prophet. So there was a time when he was behind the Prophet by himself. But we say no, this is not correct. Rather, the one who prays behind the congregation on his own, whilst he does have some space to enter into the congregation, then his prayer is not correct. And the hadith for this is coming up. But the point about this particular hadith is that Ibn Abbas did not stay there. Yes, he went behind the Prophet, but it was only for a short while. The point is, he did not stay there, so they're not the same thing. We also take that if two people are praying in the congregation, they stand next to each other. It is not the case that the imam stands slightly in front of the ma'moom just to show that he is the imam. There is simply no point in this, because we'll know who the imam is, because the imam obviously is going to make the actions before the ma'moom. And obviously we can see the ma'moom is following the imam. So we say they both stand parallel to each other, and the imam does not stand slightly forward. We also take from the hadith that performing certain actions in the prayer which are not part of the prayer is permissible if it is for the benefit of the prayer. Here the Prophet moved Ibn Abbas from the left to the right, and this was for the benefit of the prayer, so this is perfectly permissible. Certain actions in the prayer are waajib to be performed, and these actions of course not part of the actual prayer itself. For example, if you are praying and you realize that a small part of your awrah is uncovered, and this has to be a small part, then you would need to make movements to cover this small part. This movement is not part of the prayer, but it is wajib, because if you did not do so, your prayer would be broken. If a large part of the awrah became uncovered, even for a short time, then your prayer is broken. And if a small part of the awrah became uncovered for a long time, then the prayer is broken. But if it is for a short time, then the prayer is not broken, but of course it is wajib upon you to cover it. Or for example, you're in a congregational prayer and you see a gap in front of you, in the row in front. It is recommended for somebody to move in front and fill in the gap. Even though this movement is not part of the prayer, it is for the benefit of the prayer. And remember we said, the hadith, وَمَنْ وَصَلَ صَفًّا وَصَلَهُ اللَّهُ. Whoever joins the saf, then Allah joins him. Then you can have other actions which are recommended to be performed. For example, you're standing in the prayer and you feel an itch. It is recommended to scratch, because if you didn't, then this would take some khushu' away from the prayer. So you'll be similar to the one who prays and is extremely hungry, thinking about the food. This is why we say it is recommended for you to eat before you pray. If you are hungry and you are in need of food, and your hunger is going to distract you, then you have those types of actions which are permissible to be performed. These are those actions not part of the prayer, but performed for a particular need, which is not for the benefit of the salah itself. For example, we know the Prophet prayed whilst holding his granddaughter, and he would put her down when performing the sajda. And we also know the Prophet, during the prayer, opened the door for Aisha. So these are all permissible actions, because there is a particular need for these actions. Then you have those actions which are makrooh, and these are actions which you perform in the prayer for which there is no particular need, like fiddling with your clothes. Then you have those actions which are haram to be performed, and these are those actions for which there is no need, and you do them much continuously, such that if somebody was looking on, he would say, this person is not in a state of prayer. So if it reaches that level, then this is a haram type of action or actions, and it breaks the prayer, because it completely goes against the spirit of the prayer, which is that you should be still and tranquil, as if you are meditating. So the haram actions are much and continuous. So you're continuously adjusting your clothing, your watch, your ring, your hair, scratching yourself. And all of these actions are done much continuously, such that it seems that you're not actually in a state of prayer. So this breaks the prayer. All the other actions do not break the prayer. So take note of the five categories of actions in the salah, which are not pertaining to the salah itself. Can we use this hadith as evidence that you are allowed to pray a nafila in jama'ah? We say certain types of nawafil prayers are legislated to be prayed, like Salat al-Istisqa, Salat al-Taraweeh, and upon the opinion of many scholars, Salat al-Kusuf is a nafila. But what is correct is that that is a fard. But those types of nawafil are legislated to be prayed in congregation. Then you have those types of nawafil which are not legislated to be prayed in congregation. For example, the rawatib salawat, Salat al-Duha, Salat al-Layl. So as for these types of prayers, if you were to perform them in congregation regularly, this would be a bid'ah. However, if you just do it on the one-off occasion, then this is permissible, as we see in this narration. And we also know the Prophet ﷺ prayed the rawatib prayer in jama'ah with his companions, but this was not regular. It was on the one-off occasion. Hadith 337, وَعَنْ أَنَسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْ قَالْ صَلَّى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَقُمْتُ أَنَا وَيَتِيمٌ خَلْفَهُ وَأُمُّ سُلَيْمٍ خَلْفَنَا مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ وَاللَّفْظُ لِلْبُخَارِي. From Anas ibn Malik, he said that the Prophet prayed, and I and a yatim or an orphan stood behind him, and an orphan is a child below the age of puberty who does not have a father, meaning to say his father has died. We find in this narration, in the full version, that Sulaim prepared some food for the Prophet and invited the Prophet over. And after the Prophet ate the food, he led them in a prayer. And this was clearly a nafila, it could not have been a fard. And so Anas explained how they stood up and formed their rows. Him and a yatim stood behind the Prophet, and Sulaim stood behind those two. Sulaim is not a mahram of the Prophet, but she called him over to her house. So is this permissible? We say it is permissible if there will be no fitna. So in this particular scenario, there was no fear of fitna. And so if a man was to come to the house of a non-mahram woman, then this is permissible as long as the non-mahram woman has a mahram male with her, or if there is no fear that they will be alone together. So perhaps there are some other people in the house as well. And we also find that they prayed the salah on a mat. So this proves that it is permissible to pray your salah on a prayer mat. And also the yatim was standing next to Anas, so it proves that a small child can stand next to an adult in the congregational prayer, and that you don't have to send the children to the back row. Not only can a small child stand in the congregation, but a child who has reached the age of tamyeez can also lead the congregation, as we saw in the hadith of Amr ibn Salama. We take from the hadith that the woman stands behind the men, even if the woman is from the maharim of the men. So here Sulaim is the mother of Anas ibn Malik. But still, she did not stand with Anas, she stood behind him. And it also shows that women are able to pray in the congregational prayer with the men, as long as they're not mixing with each other in the saf. Although the congregational prayer on the women is not wajib, it is only wajib for men, as we discussed before. If there are only women available, then it is permissible for them to pray in congregation, and we could say it is even recommended. And in this case, they say it is permissible for the imam of the women to stand in between the women in the front row, as opposed to in front of the front row. And they take their example from what Aisha and Salama did when they would lead the women in the prayer, they would stand in the middle of the front row. So this is the difference between this and the congregation of the men. Although it appears that the issue with the women is flexible, the imam of the women could stand at the front or in the middle of the first saf, next to the rest of the congregation. So if, for example, you have a school in which there are Muslim teachers and they are women, and the salah time comes and they form their own jama'ah, then this is something good and should be encouraged. We also take from the hadith that it is permissible to pray a nafila in congregation as long as it is not done as a regular practice. So it is just done on the one-off occasion. We also take from the hadith it is recommended to respond to the call of the one who invites you over to his house for lunch or even tea. It might be that if you refuse, then the person inviting you over would take it the wrong way, that this person does not view me very highly, which is why he rejected my offer. If this invitation is for the walima, then under certain conditions it is wajib for you to attend. Also from the issues of the rows of the salah, is that you do not allow the pillars of a building to break off the saf, unless in a necessity situation. Because we have authentically in the Sunnah of Ibn Majah that the companions were prohibited from forming rows in between the pillars, and they were banished from it, because the pillars would break up the continuation of the row. But we would allow it in a necessity where you cannot help it. Another point to bear in mind is that the imam needs to stand on the same level as the ma'mumin. We have authentically in Sunan Abi Dawud that Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman was leading the people in prayer, and he was standing on a slightly elevated position. So from behind him, Abu Mas'ud dragged him down to the same level as the ma'mumin, and afterwards he told him, "Do you not know that we were forbidden from doing this?" Meaning the imam standing on an elevated position. And Hudhayfa replied, "Yes, I remembered when you pulled me down." So that is the general rule. The imam stands on the same level as the people behind him.
Hadith 338. وعن أبي بكرة رضي الله عنه أنه انتهى إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو راكع فركع قبل أن يصل إلى الصف فذكر للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم زادك الله حرصا ولا تعد رواه البخاري وزاد أبو داود فيه فركع دون الصف ثم مشى إلى الصف. From Abu Bakr He says that he came and joined the congregational prayer whilst the Prophet was in the ruku' position. So he made the ruku' before he joined the saf. And he mentioned that to the Prophet. And the Prophet told him, "May Allah increase you in your eagerness, but do not do it again." And Abu Dawood has that he made the ruku' before joining the saf. And then in the position of the ruku' he marched into the saf. Now this hadith is a delicate situation because we need to look at the Arabic of the last word. The Prophet said, "May Allah increase you in your eagerness, وَلَا تَعُدْ." But this could also be pronounced وَلَا تَعُدُ. What's the difference? If you say وَلَا تَعُدْ, it means don't do it again. Meaning that thing which you just did, don't repeat it in the future. If you say لَا تَعُدُ, it means don't rush or hurry. Because it comes from عَدَى يَعْدُ, which means to run or gallop. And this actually makes a difference. So we find the differences between not even the letters, but the harakat of the words. And it changes the ruling. Because if we say it is la ta'adu, and do not hurry or do not run, it means what Abu Bakr did was correct, but the only wrong thing he did was that he was in a hurry. So don't come to the congregation running or hurrying. Rather, take your time and come in tranquility. But as for when he made the ruku' before the saf, and then he came in, the congregation whilst in a state of ruku', it would mean that this action is correct. However, if we say that it means وَلَا تَعُدْ and don't repeat it, it means that everything he did was wrong and he must not repeat it. So basically, he hurried into the congregation, so that was wrong, and he also made the ruku' before the saf and entered the saf in a state of ruku', that was also wrong. So you can see, depending on how we put the harakat, it changes the meaning, hence it changes the whole ruling on what is right and what is wrong. So we say what is most worthy is for us to say it means وَلَا تَعُدْ, do not repeat what you did. Because this now includes more meanings. So basically, if you're in a situation where the imam and the congregation are in the ruku' prayer, you do not make a ruku' before you join the congregation. Rather, you enter the saf, make the takbiratul ihram whilst in a standing position, and then thereafter you make another takbir and go into the ruku' position. And some scholars say you make the takbiratul ihram in a standing position and you can simply go into the ruku' position and your initial takbir would suffice. However, we say it is best to make the second takbir as well. So this would be the correct way to do it and not to go into the ruku' position before you enter the saf. And this is based on the statement of the Prophet, if we take it to mean لا تعود, do not repeat yourself. And we opt for this one because it is broader in meaning, and whenever we can take a word which includes the broadest meaning, then this is what we should opt for. And other scholars have opted for the other way of interpreting it, and they say what is haram is to run to the congregation, but what is permissible is to make a ruku' before you join the saf, and then whilst in a state of ruku' come into the saf. This is also an opinion, but we opt for the former opinion. We find in this narration that whenever you join the imam and he's in a particular position, you say the takbiratul ihram whilst in a standing position. So here now you enter the salah and then immediately you go into the position where the imam is in. If it's a ruku', then so be it. If it's the sujood, then you go into sujood. If it's a sitting position, you go into the sitting position immediately. And you carry on following the imam from there. And this is in agreement with the hadith in the Sahihain, إِذَا سَمِعْتُمُ الْإِقَامَةَ فَامْشُوا وَعَلَيْكُمْ السَّكِينَةُ وَالْوَقَارِ فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَقُضُوا. When you hear the iqaamah, then walk to the prayer in tranquility and dignity. Whatever you catch of the prayer, then pray it, and the rest you make up for it. So if you caught the imam in the ruku', then you start from that, and you simply complete your prayer when the imam says the salam. We take from the hadith the virtue of Abu Bakr. How is this? We find the Prophet ﷺ said, زَادَكَ اللَّهُ حِرْصًا, may Allah increase you in your eagerness. And so when the Prophet makes a dua for you, this is clearly a virtue for you. We take from this hadith the vital point that if you catch the imam in the ruku' position, then this counts as if you caught the imam in the whole rak'ah, even though you've missed out on a vital rukun of the prayer, which is al-fatiha. And there is no salah for the one who does not recite al-fatiha. So you would think that you have to repeat this rak'ah again. As for the standing position, you did not miss that out because you did stand when you said the takbiratul ihram. But you definitely missed out on the surah al-fatiha. So this is the issue. So some scholars say that this rak'ah does not count for you because you missed out on al-fatiha. However, the point here is that the Prophet ﷺ did not tell Abu Bakr
to repeat that raka'ah because he did not recite al-Fatiha.
Which basically means that Abu Bakr caught that raka'ah with the Prophet. Otherwise, it would be obligatory upon the Prophet to inform Abu Bakr of this, that he has to repeat that raka'ah because he did not recite al-Fatiha. So we say this is the exception to the general rule. It is true to say if he did not recite al-Fatiha, you have to make up for the raka'ah. However, in the case when you catch the imam coming in late in the ruku' position, we say you have caught the raka'ah. So this is the exception. And as for al-Fatiha, we say in this case, it is forgiven from you because of the necessity of following the imam. You cannot afford to be reciting Surah al-Fatiha when the imam is in the ruku'. Because in this particular case now, you have to give priority to following the imam. So because of this priority which you have to give, we say that the al-Fatiha is overlooked. And with this we also ask a question, is it legislated for the imam to spend a longer time in the ruku' so that those people coming in late have a chance to catch up with the raka'ah? We say that if the imam suspects that there are some people who are coming in late, maybe he can hear their footsteps from behind, then yes, there's no problem if he lengthens it just a little bit, but on the major condition that it must not be so long so as to annoy the congregation behind him, because the congregation behind him, they have the priority, not the ones coming late. Otherwise, we know that the Prophet ﷺ would lengthen his first raka'ah more than the second. And perhaps one of the wisdom behind this is that this would give time for the people coming in late to catch the first raka'ah. Also, we take from the hadith the good etiquettes of teaching people, especially the ones who don't know the ruling. So Abu Bakr did not know the ruling that you don't come into the ruku' before the saf, and that you do not hurry into the congregation. So the Prophet explained to him nicely with kind words, and also made dua for him. And this always helps. Whenever you enjoin the good or forbid the evil, and teach people when they are doing something wrong, always make dua for them. So say barakallahu feek, or zadakallahu khayran, or any good dua, because this will remove any ill feeling or any grudge they may have against you. Perhaps they would be feeling, oh, who is this guy trying to tell me what to do? But if you make dua for them, this will remove any negative feelings and will soften their heart up and will make your job of enjoining the good and forbidding the evil that much easier. So for example, if you have to tell someone to switch their phone off in the masjid because it's disturbing others, then explain that to them nicely and give them the reason why you're asking them to turn their phone off or put it on silent. But also after that, make dua for them for barakah or anything which is good, just like the Prophet did here with Abu Bakr, as they will be much more likely to accept what you're saying when they hear kind and loving words coming from you. One might ask here, the Prophet made dua for Abu Bakr, what's the point in making dua? Will it change the qadr? The answer is no, dua does not actually change the qadr, but rather, dua is part of the qadr. Meaning to say, if Allah is to increase Abu Bakr in his eagerness, then yes, he will increase it using the dua of the Prophet. Remember what we said, Allah creates the end result and the cause of the end result. And all of this is part of the qadr. In the same way, if Allah has destined that you should have a child, then of course you will not have a child without marriage. But Allah Jalla wa Ala destines the end result and also the cause which will lead to this end result. So you getting married didn't actually change the qadr that you will have children. Likewise, has Allah destined that you will be in Jannah? If the answer is yes, then what is the point in you performing righteous actions? Because after all, Allah has destined for you to be in Jannah. We say, yes, He's destined for you to be in Jannah, but He has also destined for you to perform the actions which will lead you to Jannah. And all of this is part of Qadr. So the cause and the end result, these two things are part of the Qadr of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Otherwise, there is absolutely nothing which can actually change the Qadr of Allah. So this is an important point to note, that both the cause and the end result are part of the qadr of Allah, which cannot be changed. Hadith 339, وَعَنْ وَابِسَةَ بْنِ مَعْبَدْ رضي الله عنه أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ رَأَى رَجُلًا يُصَلِّي خَلْفَ الصَّفِّ وَحْدَهُ فَأَمَرَهُ أَنْ يُعِيدَ الصَّلَاةَ رواه أحمد وأبو داود والترمذي وحسنه وصححه ابن حبان. From وَابِسَةَ بْنِ مَعْبَدْ, he says that the Prophet saw a man praying behind the row in the congregational salah, and he ordered this man to repeat the prayer. The hadith is sahih. Hadith 340, وَلَهُ أَنْطَلْقُ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْ لَا صَلَاةَ لِلْمُنْفَرِدِ خَلْفَ الصَّفِ From Talq, the Prophet said, "There is no salah for the one praying by himself behind the row." وزاد الطبراني في حديث وابصة ألا دخلت معهم أو اجتررت رجلا. In al-Tabarani he says that the Prophet said to the man, "Why did you not enter with them or pull a man back to stand with you in the row?" So this latter narration of al-Tabarani is weak and the former one is sahih. It is found in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad. So we find that the Prophet ordered the man praying on his own behind the saf to repeat the prayer. So this would suggest that his prayer is not correct. And the reason that his prayer is not correct, according to what is apparent from the hadith, is because he was praying by himself. However, the big question is, in the row in front of him, was there a place for him to stand or not? Some scholars would say there was a place for him to stand, and he did not stand in that place, and he prayed by himself, which would render his prayer as null and void. Other scholars would say it is probable that there was no place for him to stand, and he prayed by himself. So even if there's no place for him to stand and he prayed by himself, his prayer is batil. So we find in this hadith, there are two possibilities. So this hadith now becomes mutashabih. It is not clear-cut as to whether the man had an excuse for praying on his own or not. What we can be sure of is, the Prophet ordered him to repeat the prayer because he was praying by himself. And we mention this point because some scholars have said, no, the Prophet ordered him to pray again because there was some other condition of the prayer which he was lacking. We say no, because the hadith says that he was praying by himself, and in the Arabic, فَأَمَرَهُ أَن يُعِيدَ الصَّلَاةِ. So the Prophet ordered him to repeat the prayer. So the fa is joining the sentences on, meaning to say, because of him praying by himself, the Prophet ordered that he should repeat the prayer. As for this fa, which we use to derive the ruling, then we find it in other evidences as well. For example, Iblis did not prostrate to Adam. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ فَفَسَقَ عَنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. He was from the jinn, so he disobeyed the order of his Lord. Meaning to say, because he was from the jinn, he disobeyed the order of his Lord. As for the malaika, they never disobeyed the order of the Lord. Likewise with the woman of Makhzum, who would borrow things from people, and then she would deny that she ever borrowed it. And so this comes under stealing, and the narration says, فَأَمَرَ بِقَطْعِ يَدِهَا. So he ordered that her hand should be cut off. So the fa is all important. It tells us that because of the fact that she denied that she borrowed other people's property, the Prophet ordered that her hand be cut off. So the letter fa is used for the sabab, or the cause for the ruling being given. However, is this ruling for the one who is not able to find any place in the saf because it is all full? Or is it for the one who is able to find a place in the saf but still decides to pray behind the saf? This is where the hadith is mutashabih. Some scholars have said that this order for the man to repeat the prayer is istihbab, a recommendation, and not wujub, obligation. We say no, this is not correct, because the asl is, when the Prophet orders you to do something, especially an act of worship, then this is wujub. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says that if a man is not able to find a place in the row and he prays by himself, then his prayer is correct and he does not need to repeat it. And the reason why the Prophet asked him to repeat the prayer is because he was able to find a place in the row, but still he did not join the row. And Ibn Taymiyyah draws an analogy. He says, the woman praying in a congregation will pray alone behind the saf by herself because she cannot join in with the men. Does she have to repeat the prayer? The answer is no. Why is this? Because the Sharia gives her a valid excuse to pray by herself in the Jama'ah. So she has a Shara'i excuse. As for the man praying by himself behind the saf, he does not have a Shara'i excuse, rather he has a physical excuse, because he physically cannot join the saf. So Ibn Taymiyyah says that a physical excuse is just like a Shara'i excuse. Hence the prayer is correct. And we feel this is a good opinion and very logical. As for the other hadith, the Prophet puts it verbally, لَا صَلَاةَ لِلْمُنْفَرِدِ خَلْفَ الصَّفِ. There is no prayer for the one praying by himself behind the row. When he says لَا صَلَاةَ, it cannot mean no physical prayer, because clearly there is a physical prayer. So what it has to mean is that his prayer is not valid. So even though the prayer is in existence physically, it is not in existence in the Sharia sense. So its presence is like its absence. So basically he has to perform the prayer again. Some scholars say, no, this means that his prayer is not complete, meaning he is not rewarded completely for it. But the prayer is actually correct in that he does not need to repeat the prayer. And they say that this is similar to the Prophet saying, لا صلاة بحضرة الطعام. There is no prayer when the food is served. It does not mean to say that you have to repeat the prayer when the food is served, rather, it means that the reward of your prayer will be less because the food will be distracting you. And because of this distraction in your prayer, the reward will be less. But the prayer is still correct in that you don't need to repeat it. But again, we say no, this is not correct. Because the asl is that your prayer is not correct in the sharia and that you have to repeat it unless you have some other indication suggesting otherwise. So with the food being present, we do have another indication. It is that the food will distract you if you're hungry. And because of this distraction, your reward will be less, although your prayer will be correct. But as for this case now, praying behind the saf, what indication do we have to say that what this hadith actually intends is that your reward will be less? We don't have any indication, especially with the previous narration with the Prophet telling the man to repeat the prayer. This further backs up the fact that this hadith means that your prayer is not sahih and yet you have to repeat it. What about if you're standing behind the row and you cannot get in? Do you pull a man back? As what has been narrated in At-Tabarani, we say no. For two reasons. First of all, the authentic hadith in the Sunan, مَنْ قَطَعَ صَفًّا قَطَعَهُ اللَّهُ. Whoever breaks the saf, then Allah will break him or cut him. So this is a textual evidence to say you do not pull anyone back. As for this hadith, it is weak. And then secondly, just speaking logically, it will cause distraction to the person you pull back. And also it will be a transgression against him, because if you pull him back to a latter saf, then the reward is less. And he will not appreciate this. And what type of feeling do you think this will harbor in his heart against you? Also, note that this hadith backs up what we said earlier with the hadith of Abu Bakr, in that you are not to make the takbir and come into the ruku' before you join the saf, because there is no prayer for the one who prays behind the saf, whilst he has some space to enter into the congregation. Of course, you could argue back and say, yes, but in this case, you're not actually praying behind the congregation, you're just going into ruku' and then you will enter into the congregation. So it's not the same thing as the one who prays behind the congregation. We say, yes, that is true. However, if you made the takbir and then entered into the ruku' behind the congregation and thereafter you entered the congregation, then it does hold true that you are somewhat opposing this hadith about the one who prays behind the saf. So you are disobeying the hadith to a certain extent. And obviously this should not be done. So therefore the opinion which says that you do not go into ruku' before the saf, rather you enter into the saf and then make the takbir and then go into the ruku', this opinion is stronger. Hadith 341, وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا سمعتم الإقامة فامشوا إلى الصلاة وعليكم السكينة والوقار ولا تسرعوا فما أدركتم فصلوا وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَأَتِمُّوا مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ وَاللَّفْظُ لِلْبُخَارِي. From Abu Huraira that the Prophet said, when you hear the iqaamah, then walk to the salah, and it is obligatory upon you to be in tranquility and walking with dignity, and do not hurry. Whatever you catch, then pray it, and whatever you missed, then complete the prayer. مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. And the wording is of al-Bukhari. We take from the hadith that in those days the iqaamah would be heard outside the masjid. In many non-Muslim countries, of course, this is not the case. Even the adhan is not heard. But back then, the iqaamah and the adhan would be heard outside the masjid. So when people would hear the iqaamah, they would come to the masjid. And we can also use this as evidence that the iqaamah can be made through the loudspeaker in the Muslim countries in which the adhan is heard. And the iqaamah should be said for the congregation and the one praying by himself, because it is fard kifaya for every salah. So somebody for every salah must perform it. He says, when you come to the masjid, then you must walk, and with two conditions. As sakina, this is when you're tranquil, so you're relaxed in your walking motion and you are taking your time. And also waqar, so this is when you're not flustered and you lowered your gaze and your voice is low, so you're not shouting and you're generally just self-composed. So as sakina and al-waqar have very similar meaning. So he's used both of these words just as an emphasis to tell you to be relaxed and composed and taking your time. And he also backed it up by saying, and do not hurry. So you must not run, and neither must you walk extra fast, faster than you normally do, just in order to catch the prayer. Rather, you walk as normal. And the reason why you walk like this is because when you're actually coming to the prayer, you are in a state of prayer, as we find in the Sahih. And because you're in a state of prayer, We know you need to be tranquil and conduct yourself with dignity. So therefore your state should resemble your state in the actual prayer itself. And we also have discussed that you catch the raka'ah with the imam when you catch him in the ruku' position. But of course you must say the takbiratul ihram in the standing position before coming into the ruku'. And the evidence for this, as we discussed, the hadith of Abu Bakrah. Also we find the order that when the iqaamah is given, it is obligatory upon you to walk to the fard prayer. Which basically means that if you're in the masjid praying a nafila and the iqaamah is given, then you need to break this nafila and walk to the congregation prayer. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the Sahih, إِذَا أُقِيمَتِ الصَّلَاةُ فَلَا صَلَاةَ إِلَّا الْمَكْتُوبَةِ. When the iqaamah is given, then there is no prayer except the fard prayer, meaning the congregation which is about to be established. So you need to make sure that you finish your nafila so you can join the imam in time for the takbiratul ihram of the imam. And this has been reported that Umar ibn al-Khattab would beat the people if they were praying a nafila after the iqama was given. What this hadith also proves is that whatever rak'ah you catch with the imam if you come in late, this will be your first rak'ah. So if you catch the imam in his second rak'ah, then the imam is in his second, but you are in your first. So you count this as your first rak'ah. And when the imam makes the salam, then you will then pray your fourth rak'ah. And it's not the other way around. So if you catch the imam in his second rak'ah, you do not treat this as your second rak'ah, so that when the imam makes the salam, you stand up to pray your first rak'ah, which you missed. No. Rather, you stand up to pray your fourth rak'ah. Of course, this isn't a four rak'ah prayer. And the reason why we say this is because the Prophet said, فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا. Whatever you catch with the imam, then pray it. وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَأَتِمُّوا. And whatever missed you, then complete it. So the tamam, which is the completion, can only happen when you've completed the first part of the action. Then the last part of the action is therefore completed. So the first part must happen first for the second part to happen. As for in some narrations where it says faqadu, then make up for it, then qada'a could mean to make up for it, which would then mean that the rak'ah you pray after the salam of the imam would be your first rak'ah. However, in the Arabic language, qada can also mean to perform something, as in the statement of Allah, فَإِذَا قَضَيْتُمُ الصَّلَاةَ فَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَىٰ جُنُوبِكُمْ. When you make the qada of the salah, then remember Allah, standing, sitting, and on your sides. So in this case, qada does not mean when you've made up for the prayer. Rather, it means when you've performed the prayer, and completed it, and finished from it. So if we understand it like this, then it becomes known that the correct opinion is that whatever rak'ah you catch with the imam, this will be your first rak'ah, even if it is not the imam's first rak'ah. As for the three madhahib of Abu Hanifa, Malik and Ahmed, they say that if you catch the imam in the second rak'ah, this will be your second rak'ah and you stand up to make for your first. But the correct opinion is with the Shafi'iyah, which is that it will be your first rak'ah, as we stated before. And the evidence is, as you have heard, Hadith 342. وعن أبي بن كعب رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صلاة الرجل مع الرجل أزكى من صلاته وحده وصلاته مع الرجلين أزكى من صلاته مع الرجل وما كان أكثر فهو أحب إلى الله عز وجل رواه أبو داود والنسائي وصححه ابن حبان. From Ubay ibn Ka'b, the Prophet said, the prayer of a man with another man is more virtuous than his prayer by himself, and his prayer with two men is more virtuous than his prayer with one man. And the more there are in the congregation, the more beloved it is to Allah. The hadith is Hasan. We take from this hadith, the Prophet is encouraging the Muslims to make a big jama'ah in the prayer. So one big jama'ah is better than many small jama'at. Because the bigger the jama'ah, the more beloved it is to Allah, and the more reward-worthy this jama'ah will be. We can also use this hadith to say that the prayer of a person by himself, if he does not come to the masjid, is still correct, although not as virtuous, because the Prophet says here that the prayer of a man with another man, so in congregation, is more virtuous, meaning more reward-worthy, than his prayer if he prayed by himself. So this would suggest now that if he prayed by himself, there would be some virtue, but it is not as virtuous or as reward-worthy as the prayer in congregation. And also the hadith about the 25 and 27 times more reward proves the same point, that there is some virtue in the prayer by yourself, but it is not as virtuous. Of course, we also said that if you live close enough to the masjid to hear the adhan, and you don't come to the masjid without a valid reason, then you are sinful. This of course applies to men. Could we use this hadith to prove that the Salat al-Jama'ah is not wajib? Because clearly there is some virtue in the lone prayer. The answer is no, we cannot use this as an evidence because, yes, there is some virtue in the lone prayer. However, just because there is some virtue does not mean you are not sinning. Rather, we say this hadith proves that your prayer by yourself is correct, so it is acceptable with Allah, but that does not mean you're not sinning. Because there's a difference between your prayer being wajib and your prayer being sahih, or correct and acceptable. So the prayer in congregation is wajib, and the prayer in your house, if you live close enough to the masjid, is acceptable, but you are sinning. So this hadith cannot be used to prove that the Salat al-Jama'ah is not wajib. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, when giving a comparison, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ تِجَارَةٍ تُنْجِيكُمْ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتُجَاهِدُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَأَنفُسِكُمْ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. So Allah is asking, should I not show you to a trade which will save you from a painful torment that you believe in Allah and His Messenger and you strive in the way of Allah with your wealth and your lives? That is better for you if you but knew. So because this belief is better for you, does it mean that there is good in both? Meaning to say there is good in belief, but there is good in disbelief. But is just that belief is better than disbelief? The answer is certainly no. Rather, this cannot prove that believing is not wajib. Just because believing is better than disbelieving, doesn't mean that believing is not wajib. Rather, believing is the most wajib thing you can ever do. And so likewise with this. This hadith does not prove that Salat al-Jama'ah is not wajib, just as that ayah does not prove that believing is not wajib. One might also say, but you can use this ayah to prove that this hadith also proves that there is no virtue in the prayer when you do it by yourself, just as there is no virtue in disbelief. We say, yes, that is true. However, the hadith which talks about the 25 grades more, or the 27 grades more, gives it in a numerical format, which would mean that the lone prayer is 25 grades less reward-worthy than the Salat al-Jama'ah, which would therefore mean that there is some virtue in the lone prayer. This hadith also proves that Salat al-Jama'ah can be performed with two people, and that's the minimum. Does this hadith mean that a man and a woman cannot pray in congregation if it's just two of them? Because the hadith says that a salah of a man with another man is more virtuous than the salah of a man by himself. So what if a man is praying in congregation with a woman? Does this not count as a congregation? We say no, this does count as a congregation. The reason why the Prophet used the word ar-rajul, which means man, is because normally it is men who pray in congregation and not women. So the Prophet is speaking out of what is most commonly the issue. Otherwise, if a man prays in congregation with his wife or his sister or his daughter and is just two of them, then this does hold true that they are praying in congregation and they are rewarded as such. We can also use this hadith to prove that if some people come in late to the prayer and they miss the congregation, then they can form a second congregation. And this is perfectly permissible and it would be better than them praying by themselves. And we also have the hadith where a man came late to the prayer and the congregation had finished and the Prophet asked one of the companions who would like to give this man a sadaqah and pray in congregation with him. And so one person got up and prayed in congregation with him. So this was a second congregation after the first one. The people who hold that you should not perform a second congregation, they say, yes, but in this particular narration about the sadaqah, that man who was giving the sadaqah had already prayed a congregational prayer, which is the fard prayer. So he was praying his nafila. It is not the same thing as two people forming a second congregation and both of them praying their fard. And so because it's not the same thing, they say it is not permissible to hold a second congregation. However, we say this is a weak opinion, because if a man could pray with the other person and he was just praying his nafila because he had already prayed the fard, so if this congregation after the initial congregation is acceptable, as clearly it is, then that two people should pray both their fard prayers in congregation should be even more acceptable. Because it is more important and emphasized to perform a fard prayer in your congregation than a nafila in the congregation. So we say yes, it is permissible to hold a second congregation. However, those people who deliberately come in late, so they don't pray with the first congregation because maybe they don't like the imam or for whatever silly reason, then this is to be rebuked. And people who do that are simply splitting up the jama'ah of the Muslims, and hence weakening the Muslims. Also, we take from the hadith that we should not have many masajid in a local area. Rather, what is preferred is to have one big masjid rather than many small masajid. Because remember, this hadith is telling us that one big jama'ah is better and more beloved to Allah than a smaller jama'ah. Of course, if there is a necessity to build many masajid because maybe the Muslims cannot have planning permission to extend the masjid, then in this case you have no choice and you have to build other masajid. We also take from the hadith that one of the attributes of Allah is love, that He loves something and He loves certain actions more than others. So not all righteous actions are equally as beloved to Allah, as is quite clear from this hadith. And of course, the love of Allah is something which befits Him and is unique to Him, just as Allah in Himself is unique, and there is nothing like unto Him. Hadith 343, وعن أمي ورقة رضي الله عنها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أمرها أن تأم أهل دارها رواه أبو داود وصححه ابن خزيمة. From Umm Waraqa, she says that the Prophet ordered her to lead the people of her dar. The hadith is Hasan. Umm Waraqa bint Nawfal was from the women of the Ansar, and she was one of the most virtuous women of the Sahaba. And the Prophet would visit her, and she had memorized the Qur'an. And the Prophet ordered her to lead the people of her house. The word in Arabic is dar. It could either mean house, or it could mean a local area or a district. If dar means house, then it's clear enough she's going to lead the members of her household. Only some people of misguidance, they say that dar can also mean vicinity or a district, which of course it can, as in the narration of Aisha, that the Prophet ordered that the masajid be built in the dur, which is the plural of dar, which means an area where people live. So a populated area, not in the isolated part of a countryside. And he ordered that the masajid should be cleaned and perfumed. And of course, we have already discussed this narration in the chapter of the masajid. But the point is, nowhere in this narration is it clear that Waraqa would be leading men in prayer. This is only the far-fetched interpretation of the people of misguidance and deviancy. We have already stated clearly before that the woman does not lead a man in prayer, neither a mahram man nor a non-mahram man. However, what this hadith does prove is that women are allowed to pray in jama'ah with themselves. So they can have a woman imam and all the other women praying behind her. Where does the imam stand? We have some narrations from Aisha and Salama that they would lead the women in prayer standing in the middle of the first row. But it appears the issue is flexible. They can do either, because there's no hard and fast rules from the Prophet telling the women to stand in the middle of the row or in front of the row. Otherwise, we need to know that the Salat al-Jama'ah is wajib upon the men, not the women. Because the aims and objectives behind the Salat al-Jama'ah are directed for the men. For example, meeting up and mixing with each other and speaking with each other and exchanging ideas and helping each other to do good and forbidding each other from evil and taking charge of the community. This is mainly men's issues, which is obligatory upon the men. It does not mean that it's not a woman's issue. It may well be. But it is obligatory and more emphasized upon the men, because they are the one whom Allah Jalla wa'ala has designed to undertake difficult tasks. And Allah has given them sound opinion and intellect, as well as giving them physical strength. So intellectually and physically they are superior. And that's the way that Allah Jalla wa'ala has designed His creation, and He does as He wills, and there is great wisdom behind His creation. Of course, when it comes to the nawafil salawat, then even this for men is better in their houses. And in the Sunan, the Prophet ﷺ authentically said about the women, وَبُيُوتُهُنَّ خَيْرٌ لَهُنَّ, and their homes are better for them, meaning for the prayer. Likewise, he says that the closest a woman is to the mercy of her Lord is when she is in the depths of her house. And also, if women come to the masajid, this could possibly lead to fitnah and temptations for the men. So this also needs to be avoided. However, after having said all that, we still cannot say that the masajid are haram for the women, because we have plain text from the ahadith which allow the women to come to the masjid. In the Sahih, the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا تَمْنَعُوا إِمَاءَ اللَّهِ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ. Do not prevent the slave women of Allah from coming to the masajid of Allah. And in the Sunan it adds, وَلْيَخْرُجْنَ تَفِلَاتِ, and they should come out not wearing any perfume. So this is the important condition. They must not be wearing any perfume, and they must not be adorned so as to grab the attention, both visually and audibly. By audibly, we mean they must not wear shoes which make noise. And in particular, we have in mind the high-heeled shoes. This is not actually permissible for women to wear, and it resembles what the Jahiliyyah women would do. They would wear some jingles on their ankles, so as they would walk and their feet would hit the ground, it would make a jingling noise which would attract the attention of the men, not visually but audibly. And Allah Jalla wa'ala talks about this in the Quran. He says to the women, ordering them, وَلَا يَضْضَرِبْنَ بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ لِيُعْلَمَ مَا يُخْفِينَ مِنْ زِينَتِهِنَّ, and do not, O women, strike your feet on the ground in order to show what you have been concealing of your adornment. Of course, nowadays women don't really wear jingles on their ankles, but they do wear high-heeled shoes which serve the same purpose. And so you'd often find the shameless, promiscuous women wearing high-heeled shoes. And it is for the exact reason to attract attention. This is the reason why they do it at a subconscious level, even if they deny it on a conscious level. Likewise, the Prophet ﷺ said authentically in the Sunan, أَيُّمَ مْرَأَةٍ إِسْتَعْطَرَتْ وَمَرَّتْ بِقَوْمٍ لِيَجِدُوا رِيحَهَا فَهِيَ كَذَا. Any woman who puts perfume on and then she passes by some people so that they could smell her fragrance, then she is such and such a person. And in another wording it says zaniya, which means a fornicator. Of course it doesn't mean she is committing fornication, but this is the sunnah of the fornicating women, to put perfume on and to attract the attention. Likewise in the Sahih, أَيُّمَ مْرَأَةٍ أَصَابَتْ بَاخُورًا فَلَا تَشْهَدْ مَعْنَ الْعِشَاءَ الْآخِرَةِ. Any woman who puts on bakhur, which is a type of perfume, then she should not witness the Salat al-Isha with us. So it becomes known to us that the woman is not allowed to put on perfume when she goes out. Because if she's not allowed to do it when going to the masjid, then it's even more worthy that she should not do it when going somewhere else, where the fitna is definitely going to be more than the fitna in the masjid. Because at least in the masjid, people do have an element of fear of Allah because they know they are in the house of Allah. So what about in other places when people don't feel that they're in the house of Allah and they don't feel any fear of Allah in their hearts? It's even more emphasized and more haram for her to wear the perfume. Further evidence to prove that the woman is allowed to come to the masjid in the Sahihain, إِذَا اسْتَأْذَنَكُمْ نِسَاءُكُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ إِلَى الْمَسَاجِدِ فَأْذَنُوا لَهُنْ. If your women seek permission from you to come to the masjid, then give them permission. So we take it is upon the woman to ask permission first before coming to the masjid. If it is well known between the husband and the wife that the woman regularly goes to the masjid, then she does not need to seek permission every time, because it is well known and the customs between the people is permission. However, we always need to emphasize the condition that they must be appropriately dressed without any perfume, and there must be no mixing between the genders as far as is possible. And we need to quote the statement of Aisha in the Sahihain, who said, if the Messenger of Allah والسلام, saw the women, meaning today after his death, the same thing which we are seeing from the women, he would prevent the women from coming to the masjid just like the women of Banu Israel were prevented from the masjid. So now you can see that even at the time of Aisha, laws were being broken and limits were being transgressed. So what would your opinion be in this day and age we are living in, when the level of ignorance is 1,000 times higher? So we say that the Muslims must fear Allah Jalla wa'ala, and this includes the men and the women, and the hudud or the limits of Allah must be observed. Note, however, there are many ulama who say that the only congregational prayer which the women must attend with the men are those performed at the dark time, which would be the Salat al-Subh and Salat al-Isha, because during these times it is dark, so the women will not appear to the men as readily. And they say these were the two prayers in which the women would attend the congregational prayer, but they would not attend during the Salat al-Dhuhr, Asr and al-Maghrib, because it is fairly light at these times, so the women would not intermingle. And this is the strict sunnah of the Prophet and the companions. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says, it is the job of the ruler of the Muslims to ensure there is no mixing of the genders in the masajid, in the streets, in the parks or these public spaces, and also in those places where the men gather, and that the ruler is responsible for this. Of course, nowadays we have the workplace in which men and women intermingle. And this is a big fitna which we are facing in this day and age. فَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانِ Hadith 344 وَعَنْ أَنَسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِسْتَخْلَفَ إِبْنَ أُمِّ مَكْتُومٍ يَأُمُّ النَّاسَ وَهُوَ أَعْمَى رواه أحمد وأبو داود ونحوه لابن حبان عن عائشة رضي الله عنها. From Anas ibn Malik, he says that the Prophet left behind Abdullah ibn Maktoum to lead the people in prayer, and he was blind. The narration is sahih. So this event happened when the Prophet ﷺ marched out of Al-Madinah for a military expedition. And we take from the narration immediately that a blind man leading the prayer is correct, even if he is leading somebody who can see. Because remember, the consideration is given to who knows more of the Qur'an and can recite it better and is more knowledgeable about the rules of recitation. Also, Ibn Maktoum was from the Muhajireen of the Sahaba and from the foremost to embrace Islam. So he had this virtue as well. And we also take that the strength to perform a particular action depends on the action itself. So even though Ibn Maktoum had this disability, which is blindness, he still had the strength and the ability to perform that particular action of being the imam. So he had the quwwa and the amana, which is the trust. Remember, we said these are the two vital ingredients to tell if a person is qualified for the job or not. And because the Prophet left him as an imam, it is not just to lead the prayer, rather it is to give a fatwa and to pass judgment between people in disputes. So we find that a blind person is qualified to be a mufti if he has the knowledge and is trustworthy. So it's not just about leading the prayer per se. And also from this narration we take the virtue of Abdullah ibn Maktoum, that the Prophet chose him above many other people because he could recite well, because he had the knowledge, because he was trustworthy. So he had all the qualities which are needed for an imam. Hadith 345 وَعَنِ ابْنِ عُمَرْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمَا قَالْ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ صَلُّوا عَلَى مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَصَلُّوا خَلْفَ مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ رَوَاهُ الدَّارِقُطْنِي بِإِسْنَادٍ ضَعِيفٍ From Ibn Umar, the Prophet is reported to have said, pray on the one who says La ilaha illallah. This is the Salat al-Janazah. And pray behind the one who says La ilaha illallah. This is taking him as the imam. The hadith is da'if. This hadith has many other routes of transmission which are extremely weak, all of them. So it appears that this hadith remains da'if. However, we can still discuss the topic in the hadith. It is true to say that anyone who outwardly expresses his Islam, then we treat him as a Muslim, and he is fit to lead the prayer. Likewise, the one who openly professed his Islam and openly showed himself to be a Muslim, then we pray over his janazah when he dies. However, if it comes to a person who was guilty of major sins and was unrepentant, or perhaps was calling to a bid'ah, then in this case, as long as he's a Muslim, the congregation does pray over him, except the imam of the Muslims or some prominent figures should not pray over him to show the other people that they do not approve of the sins which this person was committing. So take a note of this slight exception. And we also know that the Prophet ﷺ did not pray over the one who killed himself, so he committed suicide. And this in order to show that he has committed a major sin and to discourage other people from doing the same. This hadith also proves that an evil Muslim can still lead the prayer, and we have spoken about this before. However, it is makrooh to do so if you are able to appoint someone better, or if you are yourself able to go to another place to pray behind someone who is more virtuous. This is the better way. And the ulama have said it is haram for the ruler to appoint an evildoer as the imam, because no doubt his evil will rub off on the other community. And it is also reported that Abdullah ibn Umar prayed behind Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, and he was known to just kill Muslims whenever he wanted. And also he's reported to pray behind Al-Mukhtar ibn Abi Ubaid, and he was someone accused or suspected of magic. But the qa'idah, as we've given before, if the prayer by himself is correct, then his prayer as an imam is also correct. Otherwise, we should take note of the hadith authentically. The Prophet ﷺ said, ثَلَاثَةٌ لَا تُجَاوِزُ صَلَاتُهُمْ أَذَانَهُمْ There are three people whose prayer does not exceed beyond their ears. Al-Abdul Abiq, wal-Mar'atu allati batat, wa zawjuha 'alayha sakhit, وَرَجُلٌ أَمَّ قَوْمًا وَهُمْ لَهُ كَارِهُونَ The servant who runs away from his master, the woman who spends a night whilst her husband is angry with her, and a man who leads a people but the congregation hate him. So these three types of people, their salah does not go past their ears, so their salah is not fully rewarded. Or it could mean that they receive no reward but the prayer is correct, so they don't need to repeat it. Just like the one who drinks khamar, then his prayer for 40 days is not accepted. It means it's not rewarded, but it is still correct in that he does not need to repeat it. But of course, when we talk about the people hating this man, it needs to be for a valid reason. Perhaps this man is disobeying Allah. If they hate this man because this man is upon the sunnah and the congregation is upon the bid'ah, then this is not a valid hate and the hadith does not apply to him. Also note, it is not permissible to pray the janazah of someone who said la ilaha illallah, but he was known to be a munafiq. And the evidence for this is Abdullah ibn Ubay. He said la ilaha illallah and he professed his Islam openly. However, he was known amongst the Muslims to be the leader of the munafiqeen. The Prophet did pray over his janazah, but then Allah Jalla wa Ala sent down the ayah forbidding the Prophet from praying the janazah of those people who are known to be hypocrites, even if they profess their Islam. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَلَا تُصَلِّ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ مَاتَ أَبَدًا وَلَا تَقُمْ عَلَىٰ قَبْرِهِ إِنَّهُمْ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ And never pray the janazah for any one of these hypocrites, nor stand at his grave. They disbelieved in Allah and His Messenger and died whilst they were fasiqoon, meaning rebellious to Allah. So we say this is an exception to the general rule. And it is the munafiq whose nifaq is known, even if he professes Islam openly. So even if he says La ilaha illallah, even if he comes to the masjid, as long as his nifaq is openly known, then you are not to pray over him. Hadith 346. وعن علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا أتى أحدكم الصلاة والإمام على حال فليصنع كما يصنع الإمام رواه الترمذي بإسناد ضعيف. From Ali ibn Abi Talib, he says that the Prophet said, when one of you comes to the Salah, the congregation, and the Imam is in a particular position, then he must do as the Imam is doing. The hadith itself is da'if, although it does have some supporting evidences, and so Shaykh Al-Albani graded this to be sahih. In any case, the meaning of the hadith is sahih, because it agrees with the authentic hadith which we discussed, which says, فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا Whatever you catch of the prayer, then pray it. So if you come to the jama'ah and the imam is in the sujood position, you should not say, oh well, I've missed this rak'ah, because the imam has gone past the ruku' stage, so let me wait for the imam to come back up and then I'll join him. No, you are disobeying the order of the Prophet. Rather, you stand up, say the takbiratul ihram, and you enter the state of the prayer. Then thereafter, you say the takbir again, and you go into the sujood position. This is the sunnah. And thereafter, you carry on with the imam. And even logically, how do you know that this extra sajda that you've gone into, even though it is not actually counted as anything in your salah, but how do you know with this sajda you are not being raised a grade in Jannah? So the point is, you've got nothing to lose but everything to gain with that extra sajda, even if it is not counted as anything in the salah. And of course, we've said before that you catch the whole rak'ah if you catch the imam in his ruku' position. After the ruku' you have not caught the rak'ah, and this needs to be made up after the imam says the salam. And remember, your first rak'ah with the imam is your first rak'ah in the salah, even if it may be the imam's second rak'ah or third rak'ah. And we have discussed all of this before. If you come into a masjid and you find that the imam is in his sitting position, the last tashahud, then of course you have not caught the salat al-jama'ah. But if there is another masjid close by, and you know that they have not finished the Salat al-Jama'ah and you're able to catch it with them, then in this case, it is permissible for you to not join in with this congregation and go to the other masjid to join in with them, because at least then you would have caught the Salat al-Jama'ah and attained the reward for this. Then Al-Hafidh goes on to talking about the chapter of the Salah of the Musafir, the traveler, and the Marid, who is the ill person. So let's have some preliminary words first. When you are on a journey, which is classified as a journey, then you shorten the prayer from a 4 rak'ah prayer to a 2 rak'ah, and also permissible for you to not fast if you are in the month of Ramadan. And this is because, as the Prophet said himself, As-safaru qita'atun min al-'adhab. Journey is a piece of torment. يَمْنَعُ أَحَدَكُمْ طَعَامَهُ وَنَوْمَهُ. It prevents one of you from his food and his sleep. فَإِذَا قَضَى أَحَدُكُمْ حَاجَتَهُ فَلْيُبَادِرْ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ. So when one of you fulfills his aims and objectives for the travel, then let him hasten back to his family so he can resume normal life. And so because this travel is a piece of torment, so it's an inconvenience basically, Allah Jalla wa'ala has brought about some ease. And of course this is out of the mercy of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Of course when it comes to bringing about ease, Allah decides when the ease will come about. The people cannot decide. The people don't have the authority to decide, because if it was down to the people, then absolutely any type of inconvenience or difficulty would make the people bring ease upon themselves. And you would slowly but surely find the whole Sharia being eroded away, because people just want to make life easy for themselves. So this ease is not left down to the people. Rather, Allah decides when ease is going to be implemented and when it is not. And this sort of thing cannot be left to the whims and desires of man. As for the word safar, from which comes musafir, traveller, safar has this idea when something comes out into the open or in view. And this is because when a person goes on a travel, he goes out of his hometown or city and comes out into view, whereas previously he was hidden in his hometown or city. And from this also the word safira, which is when a woman exposes her face. So whereas before it was behind the niqab, when she exposes it, it comes out into view. So this word safar has this idea of coming out into view. So when you leave your city or your town or your particular locality and you travel outwards, then you are a musafir, because you've come out into view and you're not hidden in your city or your locality anymore. As for the ill person, then he also has a lightening of the load in that he's able to pray sitting down or lying down on his side, whichever is comfortable for him. And also with the ill person and the traveller, because these two conditions will handicap you somewhat, in that you will not be able to perform the acts of worship which you normally can perform, but Allah Jalla wa'ala, due to His mercy, will write down your deeds as if you used to perform them when you were normal. Due to the hadith in the Sahih, إِذَا مَرِضَ الْعَبْدُ أَوْ سَافَرَ كُتِبَ لَهُ مَا كَانَ يَعْمَلُ مُقِيمًا صَحِيحًا. When a slave is ill or is on a travel, then it is written for him what he used to do when he was a resident and in good health. The question now is the salah ever waived from the person who is ill? Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says, if the ill person is in such a condition that he is paralyzed and he's not even able to indicate with his head as he makes the ruku' and the sujood, then he does not have to pray and it is not wajib upon him. And the Hanafiya say, even if he is able to indicate with his blinking of the eyes, then even that is not good enough and the salah is not wajib upon him. However, we say, as long as his intellect is still intact, so he's still conscious, then the prayer is wajib, because even if he's not able to make any movement, so he's completely paralyzed, but still his heart is not paralyzed, he's still able to make the intention to pray. And your deeds are by your intention, and everyone will have what he intends. So as long as this intention is still intact, and this can only be intact if your intellect is still intact. This is why the madman has no intention. So as long as your intention is still intact, then the prayer is still wajib upon you, even if you are not able to recite anything or make any movement whatsoever. This is because the salah is divided into three categories. First, you have your fi'l, which are your physical movements. Then you have your qawl, which is your statements you make. And then you have your niyyah, your intention. So if any one of these three is intact with you, then the prayer is obligatory. For example, a person converts to Islam, he's a new Muslim, he does not know what to recite, and the time for prayer comes in. So he just makes the actions and the intention, because these two are intact even though he does not know what to recite. And at this point we must give some advice on this issue on taking a rukhsa or a lightening of the load. Some Muslims, due to their desires, may look into the statements of the scholars and pick the easiest opinion for them to follow in accordance with their desires, seeking a rukhsa thereby, or a lightening of the load. This is haram, and it does not hold true that you are fearing Allah as much as you are able to. Rather, it holds true that you are following your desires and just sugarcoating this by saying that you are following the statements of the scholars. And you need to be aware of those statements of the scholars which are deemed to be shadh or anomalous. You are not allowed to go by these opinions, because you'll often come across certain opinions of scholars which are very strange and not in accordance with the mainstream opinion. And so with those people in whose hearts there is a disease, they will follow these anomalous opinions if it agrees with their desires.
Let us take some review questions. Question number one. Explain this concept about changing your intention during the Salah. So changing your intention from one Salah to the other. And also, give evidence that you can change your intention from the Imam to a Ma'mum and vice versa. Question number two. If you catch the Imam in his second rak'ah, then how should you proceed? Do you begin with the first rak'ah or do you begin with the second rak'ah because the Imam is in the second rak'ah? Explain this concept. Question number three. Explain whether it is permissible to pray in isolation behind the row. Take into account all scenarios.